This is Coding Math Episode 17, Particles Optimization. I'm going to start a short series on improving this particle object that we've created throughout this series. I have some nice additions in mind for it, but it's in serious need of some optimization work before I feel comfortable adding any more functionality to it. I've wanted to get to this some time. I started out a while back explaining about vectors. They're an incredibly useful construct and make manipulating positions and velocities and acceleration forces very simple. However, with that abstraction, you lose some performance. For example, in order to get a particle's position on the x-axis, we have to say particle.position.getx. JavaScript has to get the particle object, get the position property on that object, then call the getx function on that object, which returns a number. I'd much rather just say particle x and have a direct property. That would allow particles to work with the utility functions we created as well. These require objects that have direct x and y properties. Same with velocity. I'd rather just have a particle.vx and particle.vy. I can add getSpeed and getHeading methods if I need to know those. And I think particle.getSpeed is a lot clearer than particle.velocity.getLength. So what we're going to do today is remove the vector dependency from particle. Now this is going to leave the particle object incompatible with earlier projects. Yes, we're going to break the API. Normally you'd try to avoid doing this, but normally you'd be doing all this optimization work before you released your code anyway. So I'm going to use a couple of earlier examples to show how to convert existing files that use particles. Okay, let's open the particle.js file. And right up at the top here, we see properties for position and velocity. Those are both vectors, so they get chopped right out of there. We'll replace those with variables x, y, vx, and vy, which will be the position and velocity on the x and y axes. These will all default to zero. Then in the create function, we have some more vector stuff for position and velocity. Away that all goes. We can set this x and this y to the x and y just passed in. And we can use some trig to calculate vx and vy based on speed and direction. Vx becomes math cosine direction times speed, and vy is math sine direction times speed. Hopefully you understand that by now. If not, review the earlier trigonometry and vector videos. Here, we're also creating gravity as a vector with a 0x component and either grav or 0 as a y component. Well, we can just store this as a single numerical value now, setting it to grav or 0. Like before, this allows grav to be an optional parameter. If not set, gravity will be 0. Now we move on to the accelerate function. This takes an Excel vector and adds it to the particle's velocity. But since we're not using vectors anymore, we'll have to pass in x and y acceleration values separately. So this will get ax and ay as parameters. We can just add ax and ay to vx and vy here. Simple. Just remember that any code you might have that uses the accelerate function of a particle will need to make a change here. You can still use vectors in your code, just pass in vector.getx and vector.gety separately if you use this function. Then we can move on to the update function. This looks daunting as it's all vector math going on here, but it's all going to be very simple. First, we need to multiply the velocity by friction. If you look at vector.multiplyby, all it does is multiply the vector's x and y values by the value passed in. So we can just say this vx times equals this friction and this vy times equals this friction. For gravity, this is now just a simple value that needs to be added to the y-axis velocity. So we say this vy plus equals this gravity. And finally, adding velocity to position is as simple as adding vx and vy to x and y. See? Not so bad at all. The angle to and distance to functions are also super simple. Since we have x and y properties now instead of position vectors, We just need to change the calls to position.getX and getY to X and Y. Done. Now, gravitate 2 is going to be a bit more complex. I'll just comment all this code out and start from scratch. We'll need the distance between the particles, but we'll also need the square of that distance. So I'm going to do this step by step, getting the distance on each axis, then a value called distSq, which is the distance squared, and then the distance will be the square root of that. The force acting on this particle is P2's mass divided by the distance squared. So we can make a force variable and set that. Then we need the angle between the two particles, which we can get using angle2. Then we can use basic trig to get the acceleration on the x and y axes. For x, this is the cosine of the angle times the force, and for y, it's the sine of the angle times the force. Finally, we just add ax and ay to vx and vy. Now, here's another optimization trick. If you look at the triangle that these two particles form, distance is the hypotenuse, dx is the adjacent side to the angle, and dy is the opposite. So the cosine of this angle is dx divided by distance, and the sine is dy divided by distance. So there's no real reason to get this angle and find its sine and cosine. We can just divide the values we already have sitting there. Going back to our code, we can remove all this angle stuff and use dx divided by distance and dy divided by distance instead. We just save 3 calls to trig functions, replacing them with 2 simple divisions. And we're done with the conversion. That wasn't too bad. Now we need to convert some of the old examples to use the new API. We'll start with the orbit example from the gravity episode a few weeks back. This has a couple of particles, one orbiting around the other. There's not really much to handle here. We just need to replace the position getX and getY calls to simple X's and Y's. So I'll do a mass replace there. But this example also uses gravitate2, so I figured this was a good one to test to make sure we didn't break anything, since that gravitate2 was a pretty serious refactor. So we're all done here, we test this. And yeah, that looks like a healthy orbit. Now let's move on to last week's spring1.js example. This uses lots of vectors, so will probably require some fixing up. First off, we see that spring point is being created as a vector. Let's change it so that it's just a simple object. Then in the mouse move handler, we can set x and y directly instead of using setx and sety methods. Next, in update, we see a bunch of vector stuff in the calculation of spring force. So let's just comment all that out. We'll first need the distance between the weight and the spring point. We could use the utils distance function, but let's do the same thing we did in gravitate2 so we retain the dx and dy for that little trick. Of course, this time we don't need the distance squared. Now the spring force is going to be that distance minus spring length multiplied by k. So we can just type all that in just like that. Finally, we can create acceleration x and y values using the same dx and dy divided by distance for cosine and sine, and multiply those by the spring force. And those ax, ay values get added directly to the weights vx and vy. The last thing that needs to be done is converting all those position getX's and getY's to simple X's and Y's. I'll do a couple of mass find and replaces to take care of those. And we test that. And magically, it all still works. Now, as I said at the start of this video, there are a few cool things I want to do to the particle object. For one, I want to move some of this spring stuff right into the particles so you don't have to write all this code out yourself every time. So that, with some other fun stuff, is what awaits you next week. See you then.